Only a gun in the head.
Okay, and I don't have enough of it, but then we played matches very much together. Okay, so having said that, I think as we wait for Suresh to join us, over there, I will hand over to you, Jose, to formally kind of begin. And then, no, let's not wait. We don't have those protocols. Okay. Just go ahead. We begin because 9:30 is 9:30. Okay. Please come and join.
Yes, 9:31. Good morning. Let me introduce myself. My name is Jose. I work for a company called Nash Industries. I head the job function there. I'm in this program to represent on behalf of NHRD. Okay? So, once again, good morning to everybody.
Good morning.
Indeed, it is an honor and a privilege to welcome this August gathering to the flagship program. On behalf of NHRD and on my personal behalf, I extend a warm welcome to each one of you. As most of you are aware, the Bangalore chapter of NHRD has been adjudged as the best chapter in India in the last 3 consecutive years. Therefore, we have been given an opportunity to host this program in Bangalore. Now, there are various government initiatives which are happening. One of the key programs, Make in India program, is really propelling the economy. And Bangalore is known as the startup capital. And we thought, you know, while discussing about, you know, the theme for the program, we felt that the spirit of entrepreneurship should be the right theme for this program. And that is how the theme has been evolved. So NHRD, in its true spirit and mission, aims at enabling people to unleash their best potential at the workplace. Obviously, given this vast theme of the subject, it is not possible to have, you know, to cover this program. Please come.
Yes.
In 2 days. So there are various programs which are happening from today to 9th of December at various locations. So please visit the website and see that, you know, if you want to nominate some of your friends, etc. for this program, please do that too. So the next point which I want to mention is knowledge enhances our capacity to create results. While everyone in an organization continue to focus on creating wealth, we in the HR professionals focus on creating, bringing the knowledge into the organization. So this 2 days session, the workshop, is going to impart a great amount of knowledge and which will definitely help you, you know, in translating the same into your organization and the people that you are going to work with. Understanding our mission and purpose, we are privileged to have the best thought leaders for this program. I would extend my appreciation and welcome to Professor Suresh, who's just arrived, and Professor Vasanthi has already introduced herself, and Mr. Urupa has also introduced himself. Now, I request Professor Vasanthi to introduce Professor Suresh.
Thank you. I am not going to take more than 1 minute to introduce one a dear colleague, a good friend, who's bailed me out many times.
Likewise.
But one of the interesting things, I think there are 2 things that I cherish from a professional point of view. Of course, not just the educational qualifications, but more importantly, he's one of the few PhDs we have here in our institute from Europe. And why do you think it's interesting is because the complexity of that region probably is best kind of captured in a country like India. Yeah? So therefore, when you are kind of doing your PhD and you're looking at the world around you, you're also able to kind of sense the kind of complexity. And the other thing which is very interesting is the fact that he's worked at different places. and particularly around micro enterprises, worked with the handloom sector, and then now is very, very well known at the NS Raghavan Center for Entrepreneurship Learning, which is one of the flagship incubators in the country. And I'm sure if you go on the net, there is just tons of information. We're extremely successful, and at any point in time, we have about what you were telling me after all those grand expansion plans. How many people? 130
people starting off.
Okay. So, what Suresh brings in, and I think that's one of the things that I want you to take away today and tomorrow from the session, is Suresh has nothing to do with HR. Okay? And which is why we brought him here. Because we do not want to have a bunch of people who are converted to be preaching to a choir that is converted. Okay? So over to you, Suresh. And Suresh is on a high pressure because he leaves by the 3:30 flight. So we are making sure that we do everything that we can that we get value out of it. Okay? Yeah.
Shall I get that organized? Yeah.
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thanks. I was quite surprised when Vasanthi came up and said, we're going to talk about entrepreneurship because HR and entrepreneurship really don't go along well. And if there is one department that is always blamed for not bringing in good entrepreneurial people in the organization, it is HR. So I guess you guys have to take a lot of flack for a lot of activities that happen in your offices. So I don't know how many of you all know or heard about NSRCell. Have you all heard about NSRCell? Although Vasanthi said we are the best in the world and things like that, have you guys heard of it? Are you taking us at face value? Because if you haven't heard of it, then it can't be big, right? So we have been set up many years ago. Actually, very long ago. So I was saying that you mentioned that we are world class, we are the best in the world, and as far as the conference center goes,
yeah.
Nobody has heard of NSRCell. So
well,
nice.
That's some feedback for us.
So we think very high of ourselves, which is okay. In a contained world, which is 100 acres, we are very comfortable. So NS Raghavan was founders of the when he retired, he gave us a little endowment to set up a center for entrepreneurship way ahead of his time. Because in 2002, very few people could even spell entrepreneurship in this country. And until 2007, I guess, all these so-called gurus as well weren't figuring out what entrepreneurship was. So for 2002, when we set it up, that was the dot-com bust. So there was huge euphoria in the late 90s for setting up new ventures, which was an outcome of the growth of the internet. And then when we set up a building, when we were ready to take entrepreneurs, people, ventures, and there were no ventures to start because nobody was actually starting ventures thanks to the dot-com bust. So we had to wait for a long time for people to be convinced that their idea is good enough to start a venture. So we've had one or two ventures between 2002 and 2007. But 7 is when we started to get very good ideas, very good startups, actually very good technological startups. Sadly, while Flipkart has done a lot of good for entrepreneurial ecosystem here in terms of bringing in money, but in terms of technological interventions, we've gone way back because the companies that we have seen those days, like Mango Technologies, started all of us had smartphones, but in 2007, smartphone wasn't the smartest phone was E72. Communicator was like you could flash a communicator, those were the days, and they developed an operating system for low-cost phones, which could do a lot of stunts that a smartphone could do, because low-cost phones do not have great chipsets, low-cost phones do not have great memory on it, which both of which are required for smartphones. So they were so good, they started in NSRCell, they started outside, a year later they came to NSRCell, and the software was so good that when Qualcomm, which had a $20 million funding and team from top universities,
they just couldn't match up the kind of technology that these guys had developed and eventually acquired them. So, and these guys were out here on Banavirata Road. Well, it wasn't, traffic wasn't that bad those days. We had another company called Amagi, which is doing very well now. To contextualize advertising for television. So they came here, and then we had a bunch of technology companies, but now everybody is looking at Uber of this, Uber of that, or India being seen as a marketplace. We have a billion people, so there's a lot of, even if you sell a billion chais a day, then you are extremely wealthy, right? So that is a transformation that happened because of Flipkart. So we haven't had great deep technology companies like Israel has, but having said that, we seem to see a change again, that there are companies which are back, which are looking at deep tech, because until unless they have deep tech, you can't have. All my mails are up there saying that I haven't sent my mail. So deep technology is going to, because until unless we have deep technology, we really can't compete with Silicon Valley or Israel or China for that instance. So we have had about 63, 68 companies now. Again, we are throwing this number. I asked Rajiv, who's the COO. We have created about 4,500 jobs, which are at the top jobs. I know this is very little compared to the kind of jobs that you all have to take in. But for a startups, we have had about 4,500 jobs. But more importantly, the value of all companies put together is a difference of $1 billion. So ask Rajiv, is that true? Is that, how do you know it's not true? So in the sense that there are companies like 8K Miles got in, it's listed. Amagi is seen as Series E. And then we have had companies like Mango, which got acquired by Qualcomm. We had companies like Mesh Labs that got acquired by Freshdesk. Freshdesk acquired Turtle. So in any case, like, we have had a lot of companies being acquired by Fortune 500 top companies in India. So why is it that we are so good? Not because our PGP students are starting ventures. We are one of those few incubators that are open to anybody in this country. Anybody who wants to start a venture, they can come here. Most incubators and academic institutions are open only for the alumni. So if you want to incubate at IISA, then you have to, one of the co-founders would have to be from IISA. Same thing for IITs. IIT Kanpur was the first incubator which was open. Anybody could go start a venture. But as Funny says, very few people would go up to Kanpur to start a venture. But then it's one of those first early incubators which open to anybody. IIM Ahmedabad also has an open incubator, but their focus is on science and technology. But because NSR has endowed us with money, we really have flexibility to do what we want. We're very free. We can take a high tech company which is doing cutting edge research in, let us say, how do you do contextualized advertisements on television on one side, and on the other side, we have companies which are trying to look at bamboo as a building material for engineers and architects. So we could take any company which we felt like, and most of the companies that we take are far advanced from what you know. So we don't get swayed by the buzzwords. Because Internet of Things is very hot now, we would want to have two or three Internet of Things companies in our portfolio. So we seem to go the other way. When everybody is hot about Internet of Things, we are incubating agriculture startups. So we have somebody who's doing coffee, there's somebody who's doing organic connecting, not organic vegetables, but more organic groceries and things like that. So we have, so we are completely flexible in terms of the company, the kind of people we take. And I think that's very important for institute. NSR has already given us money. So institute doesn't put us any pressure in terms of who to do. And that perhaps has been the most advantageous for us to pick and choose the kind of company. Anyway, long speech to say that we are the best in the world. So I think you can show some statistics outside of this. So coming back to the topic. I can give my spiel in terms of, assuming that all of you are interested in entrepreneurship, all of you are interested in entrepreneurship because what is this valuation, why are people becoming billionaires overnight, or why are they buying flashy cars, or, I don't know what interests you are. So what interests you are to come here, before I give my budget. What interests you are? In terms of topics.
So
what
basic question probably.
Yeah.
I don't understand. From my understanding, what is it?
It's like my mother's always concerned with, don't ever start. You have a job, keep that job. She may think that I, in some wild thought, throw this job and start a venture because I'm dealing with so many startups. And then my wife, on the other hand, gives me another reason. She said, look, she's a Sindhi. He said, I'm a Sindhi, I know business, how businesses are start. How you talk, teach is not how people start businesses. So, don't believe what you say. Go teach, people are paying, you're getting a job, so don't start. Right? Different perspective why you will start. Fundamentally, the same reason. Like, we don't know how the outcome is, we don't know what the outcome is going to be, like, don't get in there. Because the skill sets that you have are not really the skill sets that are required. So I went back when three of our cousins came up and said, you want to talk to me about entrepreneurship. I went back and said, look, your Sindhis are coming to me to find out how do you start and run this venture. Because of this uncertainty. Okay? That's the core of this entire model. Which is why it is so difficult to predict whether Flipkart is going to be around next year or not. Actually, these days, it's very difficult to predict if large companies are going to be around. Because uncertainty is increasing tremendously. Apparently, earlier the average age of Fortune 500 company that you would stay in Fortune 500 if you actually went there was 75 years. The time now is 5 years. And the direction is down. Yeah, like Nokia exists, doesn't exist, Motorola exists, doesn't exist, right? So Motorola was the one who actually came up with the mobile phone. So the way in which you commercialize, monetize, the way you go forward, even for large companies, is becoming quite unpredictable. So in a way, they're merging, right? Startup is looking at a very uncertain environment. But the certainty for, let us say, a large company used to be 75 years, now 25 years, but perhaps it's going to shrink further. Whereas for a startup, it's going to be 75 days to 12 days in terms of if you're not funded. So that's the main difference between a startup and a large company, and which is also the reason why managers find it very difficult to become entrepreneurs, because you build your mindset. The reason why, our ability, I'm not, we can learn. The greatest thing with humans is that we have a mind, we can unlearn and relearn. So for you to become entrepreneurial, or you start thinking entrepreneurially, you'll have to unlearn the way in which you deal in a large company and start to work with a small company. The other day somebody called me and said, apparently HUL is now asking some of its mid-tier managers to go work for a startup for a year. So they will pay the salary, but they'll have to go and work in a startup for a year and come back and see what happens with HUL. So there are attempts, exactly as you rightly said, that how do we create a startup environment in a large organization? Very hard. It's very, very hard. So the only way in which you can create a startup environment in a large organization is now by acquiring Google. So if we all think Google is a very innovative company. Can you tell me which was the last innovation that came out of Google which was successful?
Pixel?
What innovation?
Pixel phone.
What innovation? Google Chrome? Google Chrome? What was the innovation? What existed, what did not exist before that is made there?
Search engine. I think search engine was the only.
Search engine. How do they make money? How does Google make money?
AdWords.
So who came up with the idea of monetizing search?
Google.
Yahoo.
Alexa.
Bing.
No. Bing. Alta Vista.
People who used
the company called DoubleClick, which they acquired. So Google didn't think of that they can make money out of that. So you're doing search, you are now, so the last great thing that came out of Google was Gmail, which was quite different from email servers up until that point of time. But after that, we haven't seen much. We can say Google Chrome, we can say Google Plus, or Google Glass, nothing is successful. It is successful because it has acquired 143 companies. Facebook has already acquired about 50 companies. So how do you remain relevant? Because you really can't create this startup environment. Right now they are buying these startups because they still haven't figured out how do you create warm when you are not hungry. So the difference between a startup and a large organization is you're never hungry in a large organization. There's a saying in startup world which says that you're likely to die of indigestion than of starvation. That if you are well funded, you're likely to die. Whereas when you don't have any money, the likelihood of survival, because you start to think out of box, you're so desperate that in that desperation, you are creatively talking to people, meeting people, thinking out of box, and all of those will probably give you a solution which you have never thought of, right? When a large company, when it's 5 o'clock, you can't say that I'll get a brilliant idea before 5. Because after 5, traffic on Banerjee Road will get slow. I need to get home. So they say that you really can't have great entrepreneurial culture when you're very late. So HR guys, this is music to your ears. Give lesser salaries. Because you can say that, you know what, you want to be entrepreneurial? Guys, before hiring, you can say, you want to be entrepreneurial? Yes. Kids will say whatever to get into a company. Right? So you could say that, okay, you have an entrepreneurial stuff. How do you create intrapreneurship? Half your salary. And earn your other half of salary. Because at the end of the day, you want to be entrepreneurial, you have demonstrated, right? You can be demonstrating, saying that I'm only entrepreneurial, I'm well funded, I fly business class. You can't do all those if you are in a startup. So that's the fundamental difference, which people have really not figured out. So how do you create that same environment that a startup has in a large organization? But there are attempts to do it, and you can still figure out there are what is now known as the innovators method, that people are trying to understand how do you create not a want, but how do you scientifically go through an idea and how do you start to think of what we currently call as entrepreneurial method. So we're going to talk a bit of that. So I'll probably kick off. So what is the breaks and what's
11.
The
11.
I stop at 11?
Yes. 15-minute break and then 11:15 we go straight up to 12:30. I make sure...
12:20.
12:20?
Okay. I will have Banner and I wrote on a Saturday afternoon.
But anyway, no money. No.
Yes. I was in Delhi the other day. They were saying, look at the road, it's so empty. I said, why? You see, there's paisa hi nahi. Yeah. Okay, then we do it at 12:30.
In a large organization, what's the pattern of market? And
you hit it right. The fundamental difference is uncertainty. Right? In a large organization, the life doesn't change so much in terms of the way you need to run your organization. There is no... So you could predict to a great extent what would be the demand for school. What would be the demand for this particular product? And you know this is how, if I want, these are the, if this is my performance I would like to get to, these are the indicators or these are the knobs that I need to tweak now. Otherwise, I'm going to have a huge issue in, let's say, 2018, quarter four, or whatever. Right? So your ability to predict because the environment is relatively stable, relatively. There could be issues like this demonetization which nobody thought of, and we really don't know the repercussions of it. But a large organization doesn't have to deal with the kind of uncertainty that a small organization deals with. And that is probably the only difference between a large organization and a small organization. Because we don't have toolkits to understand what uncertainty is. Because how do we know? So if something is uncertain, why would you go there, right? We have fear of uncertainty. All of us have fear of uncertainty. We're not sure. If something we don't know something, we don't want to go there. Because we're unsure of the outcomes. We'd rather be comfortable predicting what the outcomes are, because we really know the hazards that are out there. And therefore, a lot of people would say, don't get into a startup. Right? Because they don't know what's going to happen to you. It's like a mother's always concerned with, don't ever start. You have a job, keep that job. Right? She may think that I, in some wild thought, throw this job and start a venture because I'm dealing with so many startups. And then my wife, on the other hand, gives me another reason. She said, look, she's a Sindhi. She said, I'm a Sindhi, I know business, how businesses are start. How you talk, teach is not how people start businesses. So don't believe what you say. Go teach, people are paying, you're getting a job, so don't start. Right? Different perspective why you don't start. Fundamentally the same reason. Like, we don't know how the outcome is, we don't know what the outcome is going to be, like, don't get in there. Because the skill sets that you have are not really the skill sets that are required. So I went back, when three of our cousins came up and said, you want to talk to me about entrepreneurship, I went back and said, look, your Indians are coming to me to find out how do you start and run this venture. Because of this uncertainty. You know, that's the core of this entire model. Which is why it is so difficult to predict whether Flipkart is going to be around next year or not. Actually, these days, very difficult to predict if large companies are going to be around. Because uncertainty is increasing tremendously. Apparently, earlier, the average age of Fortune 500 company that you would stay in Fortune 500 if you actually went there was 75 years. The time now is 5 years. And the direction is down. And you have likes of Nokia exists, doesn't exist, Motorola exists, doesn't exist, right? So Motorola was the one who actually came up with the mobile phone. So the way in which you commercialize, monetize, the way you go forward, even for large companies, is becoming quite unpredictable. So in a way, they're merging, right? The startup is looking at a very uncertain environment. But the certainty for, let us say, a large company used to be 75 years, now from 12 years, but perhaps it's going to shrink further. Whereas for a startup, it's going to 75 days to 12 days in terms of if you're not funded. So that's the main difference between a startup and a large company, and which is also the reason why managers find it very difficult to become entrepreneurs, because you build your mindset. The reason why, our ability, I'm not, we can learn. The greatest thing with humans is that we